Now I will deal with the anterior abdominal wall. After we remove the skin, we will be able to see the superficial fascia here, and the superficial fascia is actually, it is in two layers. The first layer is not very well developed in this subject. This is a thin subject, so you can see that there are traces of fat here, the fatty layer of the superficial fascia, or the Camper's fascia, and this is the fat. You can see some traces of fat here as well. This is the fatty layer. And then deeper to this fatty layer is the membranous layer. Here, this is the membranous layer of the superficial fascia. It is well developed in the lower part of the abdomen, as you can see. The membranous layer, or scarpa's fascia, well developed in the lower part of the abdomen. In this superficial fascia, you expect to find also, you find blood vessels like this one. This is, this vessel is the, belongs to the superficial epigastric vessels. This is a superficial epigastric vein that drains into the great saphenous vein, and it is accompanied by an artery, which is a branch of the femoral artery, a superficial branch from the femoral artery. Please differentiate between these vessels and the inferior epigastric vessels. The inferior epigastric vessels are located deep, not on the superficial fascia. And again, here I would like to attract your attention that these superficial epigastric vessels, the veins, which drain to the great saphenous and then to the cable circulation, they anastomose with veins around the umbilicus, para-umbilical vein, which are connected with the portal vein. So they present a site of a portal cable anastomosis. Now, after I reflect the fascia, you will see that the deep fascia is not very well formed in the abdomen, and so I can see the aponeuroses of the oblique muscles of the abdomen. This is the most superficial of the oblique muscles, is this muscle, which is the external oblique muscle. And you can see the direction of the muscle fibers. It is downwards and medially, and then the muscle fibers will give rise to an aponeurosis. This is the aponeurosis. It's a wide, flat tendon. So this is the aponeurosis of the external oblique muscle of the abdomen. And the lowermost part of the aponeurosis, the free border of the aponeurosis below, is a little bit turned up and forms the inguinal ligament. The aponeurosis of the external oblique has a deficiency here, and this is called the superficial inguinal ring. Superficial inguinal ring. Now, deep to the external oblique muscle is the other muscle. I will reflect the external oblique. The other muscle that is deeper to it is the internal oblique. And you can see the direction of the fibers of the internal oblique. It is upwards and medially. Exactly, it is perpendicular to the direction of the fibers of the external oblique. This is external oblique fibers, and this is internal oblique fibers. Again, the internal oblique muscle will give rise to an aponeurosis, and a part of the internal oblique, as you can see it here, this is again the internal oblique muscle, the lowermost fibers of internal oblique are actually arising from the inguinal ligament. They arise from the as well as from the iliac crest, but you can see the origin of the lower fibers of the internal oblique arising from the inguinal ligament. The deeper of the deepest of the three layers is the transverse abdominis, and here I can open the internal oblique, and you can see the transverse abdominis. The fibers here are transverse fibers. You can see them, the direction of the fibers. They are transversely located. The most important thing I want you to notice here is that in the plane between the internal oblique and the transverse abdominis muscle, this is internal oblique and this is transverse abdominis, you can see nerves, at least you can see the nerves here. This is the neurovascular plane. This is a vessel as well. So this is the neurovascular plane. The neurovascular plane, like the neurovascular plane in the thorax, it is located between the second layer and the innermost layer. Between here, it is between the transverse abdominis and the internal oblique muscle. In the thorax, it is located between the internal intercostal and the innermost intercostal layer. So you can see the neurovascular plane here. Again, it gives rise, the transverse abdominis, it gives rise to an aponeurosis. And these aponeuroses, the three aponeuroses, they will participate in the formation of the rectus sheath. This is the rectus sheath, is covering the rectus abdominis muscle. And the rectus sheath is incised now to show you the inside of the rectus sheath. It is the rectus abdominis muscle, one of the contents. And in the lower part of the rectus sheath, here, can see that there is a small muscle, triangular in shape, as you can see. This is the pyramidalis muscle. It's located anterior to the rectus abdominis muscle, but it is within the rectus sheath. Actually, it is absent in 20% of people. But most of the people, they have it. It's absent in 20% of people. So this is the pyramidalis muscle. It's attached to the linea alba, which is located in the midline. Here's part of the linea alba is shown here. I think if you go close to the site of the linea alba, you can see the fibers, connective tissue fibers, and you can see that they are decussating with each other at the linea alba, coming in different directions, opposite directions, and they are decussating with each other at the linea alba. This is the site where the linea alba, where the aponeuroses of the oblique muscles, they cross each other. And so some people regard the abdominal muscles as digastric muscles. And aponeurosis of one muscle, the aponeurosis, for example, of the external oblique muscle, it continues with the opposite aponeurosis of internal oblique, because there is interweaving of fibers at the linea alba, which is located in the midline. The rectus abdominis muscle is characterized by these fibrous lines. As you can see, these are called the intersections, the tendinous intersections. You can see one of them is located here at the level of the xiphoid process. The other one is located at the level of the umbilicus, and the other one is located in between. Usually they are three. And these are attached to the anterior wall of the rectus sheath. That's why it was difficult to remove the anterior wall. Some of the muscle fibers and fibrous tissue is still attached to the anterior wall of the rectus sheath. The posterior wall of the rectus sheath here is shown. This is the posterior wall of the rectus sheath. And you can see that the nerves and vessels, they arrive to the rectus abdominis and the rectus sheath from the lateral side. So these are the nerves and vessels coming from the lateral side. That's why it is not advised to move the muscle to the medial side. Usually you move it to the lateral side in order not to tense the nerve supply of the muscle. In most of the rectus sheath, the anterior wall of the rectus sheath is formed by 1.5 aponeurosis in most of the rectus sheath. I'm not going to go into details of the formation of the rectus sheath, but mostly it is formed by the aponeurosis of external oblique and half of the aponeurosis of internal oblique. And the posterior wall of the rectus sheath is formed again by 1.5 aponeurosis, which is half of the internal oblique and the whole aponeurosis of the transverse abdominis. Inside the rectus sheath also, you can see here I am reflecting the rectus abdominis, and you can see behind the rectus abdominis the vessel. This vessel comes from here. It is the superior epigastric. Superior epigastric, which is one of the terminal branches of the internal thoracic artery. So the superior epigastric vessels, these superior epigastric vessels, they anastomose with inferior epigastric vessels. And you can see here, this is the inferior epigastric, these are the inferior epigastric vessels, an artery and veins. These are the, and they are gaining access into the rectus sheath through the arcuate line. So the arcuate line is a point that is located midway between the umbilicus and the symphysis pubis. And it is where the posterior wall of the rectus sheath will become very thin below it. So you can see here that the posterior wall of the rectus sheath is thin. It is formed by extraperitoneal fascia and parietal peritoneum. No aponeuroses. And at the arcuate line, which is this line, exactly this line here, like an arch, see? Above this arch, it is the aponeuroses that form the posterior wall, 1.5 aponeuroses. And immediately it becomes very thin. Here it is thick and glistening, and below that it is very thin. At this point, the inferior epigastric vessels, they can gain access to the rectus sheath and will anastomose with the branches of the superior epigastric artery.